predict that we would have a series of tornadoes that would devastate hundreds, if not thousands, of properties in the county, damaging thousands of properties in the county. So we had the tornadoes, and now we're having to experience a pandemic. I've titled the theme for this year's reval, a robust market in uncertain times, and we'll certainly talk about that as we go forward. Now, I think most of you are aware that I did everything I could to get out of doing this year. I did ask the tax commissioner to allow us to delay this 1 year. I know that was a difficult decision for me to make. It was an unprecedented decision to even ask for a delay. Again, throughout my career here at Montgomery County, we've never asked for a delay before. I don't know of any county anywhere in Ohio that had ever asked for a delay before. But I wasn't the only one that was considering this. There were a number of counties throughout the state. Again, I filed a request to delay. Franklin asked for a delay. Butler asked for a delay. And then there were other counties that I talked to that were preparing to file for a delay, but they were waiting to see what happened with our request. Again, the uncertainty in the market, I think, with the pandemic, the limitations that's placed on public engagement was really one of the things that really was driving my request. I just, you know, just presentations like this, it's difficult to do these virtually. I prefer to be able to be with you in person. The interaction, I think, is more effective. So just those types of things was one of the reasons one of the primary reasons why I thought a delay would be in order. Of course, as you know, the tax commissioner did not agree with me, and he denied our request for a delay. And that's understandable. Again, there's not a lot of precedent for this. He reached back into the 1920s to try to find some precedent, but it's really even that there was an opinion back in the 1920s that he referenced in denying my request, but even that did not really wasn't on point. I don't think the bottom line is he didn't feel like there was any wiggle room in state law that would grant us a delay. When I talked about our inability to interact with the public and engage with the public, he was very quick to point out to me that the law does not require us to do informal reviews or provide that opportunity to the public, and so there was no requirement for that. And so that not being allowed, he appreciates that, and he thinks it's great that we do those things, but he didn't feel like that he could grant a delay because of that. So we have moved forward, and I respect his decision, and we've moved forward to complete this year's revaluation. The bottom line, I think he, as I've told several of you already, I think he felt like the only way he could grant a request is if I told him I couldn't get the work done, and I really couldn't do that, in all honesty. So we have moved forward. We have submitted our tentative abstract to the state, and we are prepared to talk about tentative values as we announced last week. So our preliminary results at this point indicate a total increase in property value countywide of 7%. That is the highest increase the county has seen in 15 years since 2005. It equates to a total gain in value of $1.8 billion. That's significant when you add it to the 2017 triennial, where we saw a 4.5% increase. So we're continuing this tradition of growth in the economy and growth in property value. So in 2017, we gained $1.2 billion. So between 2007, 2014, during the height of the Great Recession, the county lost $3.5 billion. And now, between the update in 2017 and then this year's update, we've gained back about $3.3 billion. So we're almost to the point where we were prior to the recession. We're not quite there. We're just a little bit behind, but we're looking at about $28 billion. And again, these preliminary numbers, but at this point, we're looking at $28 billion in total value for the county. So almost back to pre-recession levels. 66% of parcels will see an increase in value when we release results to the public, when individuals get their notices from us. 70% of residential parcels will see an increase. Again, this is a big turnaround from the revaluation done and completed in 2014. In 2014, 70% of the residential parcels decreased in value. Now 70% of residential parcels are seeing an increase in value. And it's true that the same switch, that same flip-flop has occurred in terms of neighborhoods. 2014, as this graphic shows, 2014, 71% of neighborhoods decreased in value. 2020, now 75% of neighborhoods increased in value. Of course, it's important to recognize that there's still neighborhoods that are decreasing in value and still homes that are decreasing in value that have not responded to the rebound and recovery of the market. So we're still dealing with that as well. And it's one of the things that makes this a complicated process and always does. But we are seeing this flip-flop that in comparison to what occurred in 2014. We're seeing double-digit increases. And again, if that was one of the things that I felt was going to be challenging about this year's update is because I knew that the market was recovering very rapidly and we had a very robust housing market going on and record setting, however you want to put it. So we've got 332 of our neighborhoods that are increasing by double digits. That's about 30% of the neighborhoods throughout Montgomery County increasing by double digits. More than 81,000 parcels in the county will see a double digit increase in their value. So we're into the teens, some of them into the high teens. More than half of the parcels that are increasing in value are increasing by double digits. Again, just as a very, very much a turnaround from what we were seeing back in 2014, 2011, 2014. These results indicate values increasing in every jurisdiction in the county, except one. The one jurisdiction where we do have a slight decline in value is the village of Phillipsburg up in our northwest corner, but every other jurisdiction is seeing some increase in value. This map, the darker the green, the higher the increase, a percentage increase in value. So you can see, I mean, those are pretty strong numbers throughout the county in terms of increases in values. My friends in Harrison Township, I know, or will be happy to see an increase in value. They were, I know, concerned, I think 3 years ago when we announced that they were the only jurisdiction that saw a decrease. So happy to see that turnaround. Again, most of the jurisdictions seeing significant turnarounds or increases in their values throughout the county. So subdivisions with the most growth, and there's some new numbers here and some very encouraging numbers here, I think, for some of our officials. These are the subdivisions. When we talk about a $1.8 million increase in market value, this is where we're seeing the most predominant, most of that. So you see the city of Kettering, who was the big gainer in values 3 years ago. They continue to be the big gainer this year. And now now the city of Dayton up there with them as well, which is a big turnaround for the city of Dayton. I think the city, 3 years ago, the city's increase was less than 0.5% or something. They did have an increase, but it was a very small increase. And now we're looking at about a 5% increase in the city of Dayton. And so those are big numbers for Dayton. Between Kettering and Dayton, you look at 28% of the entire county property value growth is just in those two jurisdictions. Again, Washington Township, Miami Township, Huber Heights, Centerville. Huber Heights is another big jump there in this list. We've seen the growth in those southern suburbs has been coming, for a number of years. But the Huber Heights and Dayton is new to this list of being the top gainers. Nonetheless, the southern suburbs still make up the largest percentage total of growth in the county. The southern suburbs making up 56%, more than half of the growth we're seeing in the county coming from those southern suburbs. But the urban core at 18, the northern suburbs, Huber Heights, Vandalia, Inglewood, Butler Township, those areas, a 19% increase in those northern suburbs. And then what I'm referring to is the rural west. And so those would be the townships and villages along the western border of the county, including Brookville, New Lebanon, Farmersville, and Germantown, German Township. We see a big turnaround this year in terms of property increase by property class. In residential increase, about 7.4%, so a 7% overall. Residential 7.4, a little bit better than the overall. A commercial increase, almost 6%, and that's very significant. 2017, go back 3 years, our residential increase in 2017 was 6.3. So we're seeing another percentage gain there in the residential. But the big gain is in those commercial values. And again, we saw an increase in 17, but just barely. And now we're looking at a 6% increase countywide, and we think that's significant. As you can see here, this is tracking the percentage gains at every update. So the residential values responded to the started showing recovery much quicker than the commercial values, but now you can see the commercial values are catching up pretty rapidly. And this graph shows the commercial percentage increase in commercial values by jurisdiction. Every jurisdiction had a positive increase in commercial values. Of course, now Jackson Township and New Lebanon up there at 20 and 25%. Those are big numbers. Jackson Township and New Lebanon had just a few properties out there, commercial properties out there that sold during the last, during this cycle, that's really driving that. And so it doesn't take much in a jurisdiction the size of Jackson Township and New Lebanon. It doesn't take much for the percentage value to show a big jump. So those are kind of outliers. But as you can see, the other jurisdictions in the county, a number of those jurisdictions well above 5%. Miamisburg above 10, Miami Township, Phillipsburg above 10. You know, these are very strong commercial value numbers that we're seeing throughout the county, and we think it's worthy of note. Okay, so those are the results that we're seeing, and so let me talk a little bit about you know, what's driving those results, or what's impacting those results more than anything else. So let me talk a little bit about the work that was done over the past 2 years. Of course, we used a new appraisal company this year as a partner. We partnered with Lexer Appraisal Services, which is offices in Centerville, or south of town. So we partnered with them this year. So it's a new partnership for us. And they brought to the table some new technology that was, I think, very beneficial to the project. Their street level imaging, that's what we started when we kicked off the project in September of 2018. That's where we first began, is their work to capture street level images using this mobile camera system on these vans. They drove more than 7,200 miles around the county taking images. The system that they use captures an image every 15 feet. So it's 352 images per mile. They collected a total of more than 5 million images. Again, an incredible resource to help them and us moving into the future to examine these properties. And it really proved beneficial when we got into the tornado damage. In addition to the street level, we had new oblique aerial images. So again, another partner of Lexer's, flew aerial flight patterns over the county, multiple flight patterns, which gives us a 360-degree view of parcels. They covered more than 464 square miles. All of this data integrates with our geographic information system. Again, it's an incredible resource that they were able to use to examine properties and to look for differences. And along with their field work, it was an incredible amount of data to examine and to review, and really put us in great stead going forward.